The real adventures don't fit conveniently between a sunrise and a sunset. That spark of excitement and the tingle of consequence that drives us all happens when the world is sleeping. When the air is brisk and a cloak of darkness leaves you alone at the center of a pinprick of light. Within the edges of a headlamp's beam, everything is in sharper focus, and the dark magnifies your heartbeat. We strive for this same focus once the sun has risen, dedicating our time and our bodies to perfecting it, that focus. We can find it in the sound of our partner's whoop when they're high above us, and we can find it during the crux of a run out. We find it in the grit between our teeth when we're 6 days into red pointing a root. We find it in the constellations of crimps that we know will go. We find it in a perfectly slotted stopper, in the light of the setting sun. We can find that same focus 10 pitches in when the sun is long gone. These moments are the most real, and they aren't limited to the daytime hours. The thing is, the dark isn't the end of the day. Sometimes, it's just the beginning.
Welcome to Stockholm. We're gathered for the grand opening of the Black Diamond Project. It's been dubbed as the hardest route ever set indoors. Five of the world's best climbers are here to give it a try. Let's head inside klattercentret and see what it's all about. So we're here inside the fantastic klattercentret telephone plant, amazing centre, and in fact the project's right behind me, and I'm here with klattercentret's very own Bjorn Paul, the event organiser. Bjorn, tell us a little bit about the format.
Well, the format is, basically we set a super hard route, which is basically a lot of boulder problems that stacked on top of each other. And they start fairly easy, like 6A boulder, and then get gradually harder until you get this 8C boulder on top.
Right, okay, so really hard.
Really hard, proper hard.
And what's the concept behind the actual route itself? This isn't something that's just here for a week or a month.
No, it's a permanent route. Well, permanent-ish, I mean.
Until it gets done.
Exactly, or we get bored.
The climbers that are here, we've got five of the world's best climbers. How did you select those five athletes?
Well, I wanted world-class athletes, obviously, but also different athletes, because it's a different route, so that's why we have specialist competition climbers and we have specialist outdoor boulders and got a girl.
Is it possible to come up with a grade for a route like this, or is that just too hard to call?
I mean, it's really hard to put a grade on something that hasn't been done. I mean, not even all the moves have been done. So I'm not going to speculate too much, but it's I think it's probably the hardest thing out there or in there.
Well, with that in mind, the hardest thing out there or in there, and with absolutely no idea how hard this thing is, I suppose I should probably give it a try. So, thought I'd try the Black Diamond Project route before any of the athletes turn up. Give it a little burn, see how hard it really is. Let's check it out. Problem is with wearing a GoPro when you're climbing, is that you can't see where you're going a lot of the time.
This is where it gets interesting. Now into the slopers. Into the toe hooks, double toe hooks, and breathe. Unfortunately, this is the part where it gets hard. Blame it on the GoPro. It was good. I feel like I know the sequence, but it just gets so hard so quickly. And it just kicks in. When you've got this on your head, it's so distracting. And I'm also not strong enough to climb the Black Diamond Project. Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to Stockholm. Alex Magos has joined me this evening. Alex?
Correctly, I'm joining you this evening.
We are indeed, and now everybody in the audience should be able to hear me. Stockholm, good evening. The crowd are fired up. It's going to be a big night. Are you guys excited? Good. And what about Alex Magos on the commentary? Woo! So tonight we've got five of the world's best climbers lined up. Who wants to see the climbers? I'm sure you guys at home want to see them, so make some noise for our first climber this evening, Jörg Verhoeven. Keep that noise going. Jörg, here he is. And of course, our second climber of this evening.
The second climber of this evening is local hero over here, Kaisa Rosen.
And keep that noise going for Mr. Stefano Ghisolfi.
Number four is the only man who has climbed the V17 boulder probe, Nalahuka Taiva.
And last, but by no means least, keep that noise going for Magnus Midbø. So, ladies and gentlemen, these five climbers will be pitting their wits against the Black Diamond Project. Give them one more round of applause. Make some noise. Those guys are gonna go and get prepared. Jörg, you need to make sure you go and get tied in. We're gonna have a quick chat with Jukki Berglund, and then Jörg's gonna be climbing. One more time, round of applause. Off you go, guys. Jukki, get over here.
Hello?
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Yeah, great. So, Jukki.
I'm a bit nervous.
Jukki, tell us about what it involves to set a route like the Black Diamond Project.
Well, a lot of hard thinking and a lot of trying and failing.
A lot of feedback as well. And tell us how it was to set with the kilter grips.
It's been fun. Can anybody hear me right now? Should I raise my voice? Well, it's been a lot of fun setting with the kilter holds. Oh, and it works now. Perfect. Sorry for it.
you, Kit, we're going to take a risk. Okay, we're going to hold the microphone here. This is live TV, so ladies and gentlemen.
Right here. Yeah.
So, last but not least, what was the inspiration behind setting a route that's going to be the hardest ever to be set indoors?
Oh, that's a hard question. I don't know. It's the inspiration, our idea. Me and Robin set this route. I think our whole idea was to make a route that's interesting and really fun to climb on, to work on, for everybody. Not only for the professional, the best climbers in the world, Alex Tanamigos, but also for the beginner climbers. Been climbing for like 6 months. Maybe.
Like me.
Yeah. Or and like me as well. I mean, yeah. So just trying to make we sort of made this route up in parts, different sections. And so we just try to make every section as fun as possible for the climbers at that level. And hopefully even the top part is the same amount of fun for the best climbers in the world as the start is for the beginner climbers.
Well, having climbed the star, I can tell you that it is a lot of fun. And thank you so much, Yuki, for setting the route and for joining us. And up next, we're going to have Jörg Verhoeven.
I'm Jörg Verhoeven. I'm Dutch. That kind of says it all, I think. I'm a rock climber. I'm 31 years old. That's like double the age of Alex Magus. I don't think I really have a climbing style. I just try to get my way up there, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. Probably this time it won't. First of all, it's a cool route. Like, I think a lot of people are going to be psyched on trying it. Difficulty increases by the meter, so basically everybody can try it. The top is very hard, so it's gonna take a very strong climber to actually do it. So I think it's a good challenge. I mean, it's out there and for everyone to try. Whether people will succeed, we'll see in the future. It's quite nice to see all these guys. Some of them I know for quite a while, so I can make fun of them and they won't be angry at me. And some, they know me, Kaisa knows me since shortly, so she'll get to know me better.
You'll be able to hear Alex Magus in the background throughout the evening. You'll be able to see me sat down at the front. I'll be doing my best to bring you the action as it happens. And Alex will be making sure the crowd know exactly what's going on. If you are tuned in online, a very warm welcome. Great to have you all on board. Don't forget, if you want to get in touch, you can do so using Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook. Use the hashtag TheBDProject. It's in the top right hand of your screen. And off he goes. So you saw the low section of the route. These wonderful kilter grip holds. And he makes that first clip. Climbs into that box position. Clip by clip, he'll move through this steep roof section. So then he moves onwards to that double jug. Now this is the part where I fell off. And Jörg takes that sloper, presses that right foot, reaches over with the left hand to those crimps, and then up again to the next one. Now those crimps look pretty positive, but let me tell you, when you actually get there, they're very, very poor. Jörg will then move crimp through crimp, and check this move out. So you'll make this clip and then you have to roll inside with the right hand, lock that in, make another clip, high left hand. And then this is where it gets hard. Look at that, there's absolutely no
no holds there for his feet. And he moves bit by bit through these slopers, and this is a really powerful sequence. Of course, all these climbers have had chance to try this in the past. They've had a red point session the day before yesterday. All the climbers had one go yesterday as well. And this move, the dyno, Jörg sticks it first go. Awesome work. If you are tuned in and you'd like a shout out, then make sure you drop us a comment. Noah Bake's done that. Noah Bake, hello. Hannes Huber, Steve Reed, Andy Holder, lots of people getting in touch on Facebook. You can do the same, just drop into that live chat. Jörg at this point is just below halfway. He's got a lot more climbing to go. And of course, this route gets harder with every single move. And you can see Jörg starting to struggle. Jörg's climbed multiple 9As. He's bouldered V15. This guy knows how to climb hard. So when you see people like Jörg struggling, that's when you know that it's very, very tough indeed. Puts in that bicycle with the foot. Oh, and he's off! Jörg straight out of there. So let's see what Jörg's got to say. So, Jörg, talk us through what happened.
Talk us through the life of an old man. Well, it went on. It started off pretty well, actually. And then right about there, I got pumped already.
The first roof?
Yeah. No, a little bit later. Well, you see those big blobs over there? They're not as good as they look. So I had some troubles over there. Then there's a pretty big void. And the other guys are going to make it look easy, but it's not. The jump is pretty hard. You might have seen it was pretty close. And afterwards, I was just shitty pumped. So, I fought my way through.
Well, it was a good fight, wasn't it?
That was a couple of meters lacking, but we can call it a close call, can we?
We can almost call it a close call. Alex, he's got one more attempt. Do you think he's going to beat his high point?
Well, considering that he is a bit older now, I reckon he'll match his high point, but he won't make it any better.
Very positive words from Alex Magos there. Thank you so much, Jörg. Good job. Let's see you in the next round.
All right. The next round.
Yeah, you've got another go, yeah.
He didn't even know.
Keep that round of applause going. And welcome our next climber of the evening, which will, of course, be Kaiser Rosen.
So my name is Kaiser Rosen, and I'm 19 years old. I'm from Sweden. I'm a climber, obviously, and I do both like outdoor climbing and competition climbing. I've done mostly rope climbing so far, but I do a lot of bouldering as well. My climbing style, I don't know. I think it's slow and steady. Yeah, it's quite slow and steady, and static move. Very static. I don't climb like a girl. I'm more like power.
No. Okay.
The route is very difficult for me, and it won't suit my style. Maybe the first 6B part. The format is very unique, you know, and I don't know. For me, it's very hard to like deal with the fact that I won't be able to top it or even reach like how far I really want to reach, you know. It's different, but it's exciting. Yeah. It feels like it's less pressure. That I don't need to compare myself to the other girls, and that's good. But it's still like more pressure somehow because I won't be able to climb as far as they do. However, I really want to. I want to show them like I'm a girl. I'll top this route. But unfortunately, that's not the way it will end.
Swiss climber will begin her attempt. Lots of questions coming in on the social media. Big thank you to everybody that's getting involved. Jörg was our first climber, and all the climbers will get two attempts at this route. And of course, this competition has a little bit of a difference. It's not the conventional competition in that this is an open comp. Once these guys have finished climbing, the competition doesn't finish there. Anybody can come and try this route, and it will stay up until it's topped. €5,000 will go to the first person to top this route. So Kaiser begins and makes the first and second clip in quick succession, moving between those kilter slopers. Lots of people shouting out from all over the world. We've got people in Hawaii, we've people in Montreal. Wherever you're tuning in from, let us know. Shout out to Eddie Folk of the circuit, he's tuned in. And this is the point where Kaiser will make that clip behind her, reach over that box, and you can see the hole that she's jumping to. Now I opted to stick my foot high, exactly as Kaiser's doing, that's exactly what I did. Not to say that I showed Kaiser the way, she definitely was showing me what to do. Very talented young climber, best known for her competition climbing, but she does climb outdoors as well. Just seeing that competition strength, shaking out on those holds as she moves through the roof. There's no time limit for these guys. They just climb till they fall. I'll tell you what though, there's not many places to shake. Big shout out to Hungary and of course Louisville, Kentucky as well. Lots of people are tuned in. We've got some Germans tuned in. Israeli as well, so many different countries. It's awesome to see you all. Kaiser reaches over to the first hold of the lip, reaches that jug, places the right foot, matches in with the left hand. And look, she's opted for different beta to York. She goes right hand, then left, then right, instead of left, right, left, and uses the hold on the volume, which everybody else is just using as a foothold. Great to see her strength on that low move. Big reach with the right hand, makes that crimp, and it's a really precise hold, that one. You can't see on the top, but there's a lip. And another big move there for Kaiser. She was worried about this one yesterday in the working session because it was so far for her. And you can see how strung out she is. Cranks in on that right hand. She's got to lock that left arm down. Oh, and she's off. That's the first fall there for Kaiser Rosen. Hard move. Let's see what she has to say about her attempt. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I thought Kaiser looked so strong through that low roof.
Definitely. I mean, just remember how Liam Lonsdale climbed through the roof, and then you realize, oh.
Yeah, I definitely didn't make it look as smooth as you did. How hard would you say, for the sake of everybody here, how difficult would you say the roof section is, the first roof?
It's not very hard, because it's very good holds, but at the same time it's like a bit off and for me a bit swingy and tricky.
If you had to put a grade on the first section, what would it be?
I don't know, like a root or a
yeah.
I really can't tell. So
7A plus plus plus.
Oh, plus plus plus.
Well, plus. Great job, and you have one more attempt, so hopefully you can do better on the next one.
Yeah.
Good. One more round of applause for Kaiser Rosen. And keep that round of applause going and welcome our next climber, Stefano Ghisolfi.
I'm Italian, I'm 23 years old, almost 24, tomorrow is my birthday, and I'm a climber, basically a climber, and that's all. I specialize in rock climbing and sport climbing, not bouldering, not speed, and especially competition and rock climbing. Yeah, it suited me because I used to rock climb, where maybe responding a project outside is pretty similar. In a competition, everything is on site. Here is a red point, is basically the same thing, but it's on plastic, and there is a big and strong crew around, and it's not always happening in rocks. Most of the routes I try, I'm alone with my girlfriend, so it's funny, and it's a good format, I think. I don't like slab, I like really overhanging walls, so I'm a bit powerful and dynamic, and I'm pretty light, so this helps me for climbing without feet. Yes, it suits me because I like roofs. I'm pretty strong on roof, I think. I like small holes. These are more compression holes, like big holes, but I will try it anyway. Yeah, it's great because there are so many different people from different countries, and they are really nice as a person, as really strong as climber. We have always different styles because Nale is a boulder, and Jorge is an all-around climber. Alex is not climbing, but
pro belayer,
Alex is pro belayer, and so we're having a lot of fun.
Well, there was Stefano Gisolfi, and there is Stefano Gisolfi, whose birthday is indeed today. Stefano has climbed very hard routes. In fact, he climbed only a few weeks ago, first round, first minute. Phenomenally hard route in Margalef, 9B. And in fact, Alex Magos was the B-layer. It was his first 9B B-lay tick. It's not his first 9B. Stefano Gisolfi also did the first ascent of a 9B in Italy last year. Big shout out to Annie Bertling. She's tuned in Finland. Louis Parkinson's tuned in the UK. Kaylian Harker, Mr. Seahawk, Ian Hansen, Alex Laderna, we've got Brett Weiss, Lucas Horch, we've got people tuned in from Thailand, all over the world. It's wonderful to have so many people tuned in. And there you can see Stefano making those first moves through that box section. Stefano is actually the shortest male. He's just a touch taller than Kaiser, but he's incredibly dynamic, has to be, being the slightly shorter climber. You see him using that left heel on the sloper. Adam Wallace has tuned in and said, where's the comp being held? This is at klattercentret Telefonplan here in Stockholm, Sweden. Ian Hansen's asking if I tried the route, and I did indeed. You'll be able to see that in the replay. We showed a clip of that. Some very attractive GoPro footage of my face. Not. You see Stefano crimping hard on those holds. He makes them look a lot bigger than they are. Lots of Norwegians tuned in. Big right hand crimp, reaches over with the left foot, takes that crimp with the left hand, and this is where he needs to cut. Makes the clip with the right, and he'll have to roll underneath himself. You see him drop that right knee. There he goes, pinches that volume, and then reaches above his head to clip, because this next section is hard. Zara Gripo's got in touch. Of course, that is Stefano Gisolfi's girlfriend. Ciao, Zara. And you see him standing in the seam of that wall, reaches up through those slopers. Of all the climbers in the competition that are here, they all said that they thought Stefano had the best chance of getting the high point. And those slopers are absolutely terrible. Those kilter grip holds, whilst they look big, really, in that angle, are not as good as Stefano makes them look. Reaches over with the right hand, and keep your eye on this next move. Boom! Stefano Gisolfi cruises the dyno and asks the crowd for some support, and of course they're more than happy to give it to him. Big reach now up for this next sloper. And he's almost in the horizontal section. He's still below the halfway point on the route. Cole Mulders asked, how's the route chosen? Well, it's set by Robert Rundin and Jukka Berglund, who are klattercentret setters, both extremely strong climbers. Stefano Gisolfi, of course, won his first World Cup of the season this year in China. It was his only World Cup gold this season. Big rollover with the left hand into the sloper, and he'll match him with the right. Check out this sequence. Up with the left, and he goes again. Oh, he's matched. We saw Jörg go again. Stefano opting to go with the left
right toe. Look at that, cuts loose. He's fully horizontal now. Pushes hard into it. Look at him go. So strong, and the crowd loving this. 24-year-old Italian is cruising at this point, shaking between the moves, and you can see what's to come. Those kilter grip holds, very, very tough to hold. Very tough to read as well. This next section, of course, proved the difficult one for them to work out in the beta session. Magnus Nale and Stefano all had trouble working out the moves, as did Jorg as well. But they did find a sequence that they thought might work. Matt, he's in on that blocks volume and he hits it. That's a high point. Look at him go, whoa! Unbelievable work from Stefano Gazzolfi. Very, very strong. Now let's see what he has to say about that. Well, you certainly looked pretty strong. What did you think of that, guys? I have to say, the guys at home on the live stream are going absolutely crazy for your attempts then. The comments that were coming in, they were very impressed.
Oh, thank you. It's a good birthday present.
Yeah, great birthday present. You set the high point.
Yeah, so far.
And so you've got a second attempt. Do you think you can beat it?
I'm pretty tired. I don't know.
Do you guys think you can beat it? Well, we've got a knife, we've got a spoon, and we've got a plate. So maybe you can have some power cake, and we'll see you again in about half an hour.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you very much, Stefano. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So, Stefano's going to go have some birthday cake. Alex, are you going to get some cake?
Of course I'm going to get some cake.
You can throw the flowers if you want.
To the lucky woman.
Next climber is going to be the one, the only, Nale Hukkataivo.
My name is Nale Hukkataivo. I'm a professional climber, travel around the world pretty much full time and climb on the rock mainly, bouldering more so, but it's for climbing here right now. So I used to have a climbing style, but I think in the last years, not so much, because I've been pretty much focused on trying to keep the focus on what my weaknesses are and just develop as like a pretty rounded climber. So that's the thing, like if I go to a sandstone area for say 2 months, then I'll be really strong on slopers and compression. If I go to a granite area for 2 months, I'll be good on crimps and static climbing. So it always depends. Like, well, considering the last time I roped up was last June and it's February now, so not perfectly, but I think it's really powerful. So the power helps, but really lacking on the endurance department for sure. Oh, I think it's cool. I don't know if anyone's done a comp like this quite before. The idea is that they set a really hard route that gets harder and harder progressively towards the end, and you kind of just go at it like a outdoor climb. You just try to get your high point, you know, try to get as far as you can. I think the way they said it, it went goes from like 6A boulder in little sequences, gets harder towards the end, and the last sequence is supposed to be around like 8C boulder apparently. So I'm sure it adds up to like 9B plus 9C route, whatever that could be. But I don't think any of us really even tried the last couple of moves, so it's pretty hard to judge. But I think it's a really cool concept because it relates to outdoor climbing. It's like the same mentality that you're not just like trying to do a climb that was set for the comp to be climbed today. Like, you know, it's a really hard route and you're just trying to climb it in general and see how far you can get and improve. And it will be on the wall for possibly years after this so people can come back and try it. So I think it's a really cool idea.
Was Nale Hukkataivo. Learned a little bit more about him there. And of course, Nale is regarded as the best boulderer in the world now since he sent Burden of Dreams, the world's first Font 9A or V17 boulder in Finland. The last time that Nale tied into a rope, apparently, was June last year. So this is a lot more moves than he's used to.
Almost 4 years, so that means 17s, always
If you're wondering where the competition's being held, we're live from klattercentret in Stockholm. Good afternoon to Dan Verge. Leah Crane's tuned in. We see Nale moving through the relatively easy roof section. I say relatively because I'll tell you what, it is not easy. These moves really tricky. Of course, these climbers all very capable of climbing 9A and above. Nale's climbed a few 8C pluses. He said he doesn't think he's ever red-pointed 9A. Certainly not in the French grade, of course. He has got the first and only Font 9A to his name. Moves up through those crimps. Moving quickly, hopefully trying to keep that pump at bay. Makes the clip. Big reach with the right hand up to that right hand crimp, shoulders it down to take the left, and you'll see him make the clip with the right hand and then roll underneath to that big pinch move. There it is. Nice and strong from Nale so far, as to be expected. High clip now before he reaches up to those slopers. There it is. Stands in the seam of that wall to move between the two big pinchy slopers. Oh, and he's off! Falls low down, obviously pumped. Shrugs his shoulders. We'll go and catch up with Nale and see what he thinks of that. I reckon he's got more in him than that. Low fall from Nale. Let's go and catch up with him and see what he thinks. So, Nale, how was that?
Pompey as I expected. I didn't really go for the link on the working day, so didn't really know what to expect. Just kind of worked sequences and was hoping for the best, so I guess that's all you get. That might have been my warm-up goal. We'll see if my forearms actually recover during this day. So,
of course, that's worth mentioning is that actually in the red point session, you never tried to link the moves. Like you said, you were just working the individual sections. We thought you were maybe going for the dark horse method.
Well, I think if I managed to stick to dyno, I think the next sequence I had pretty dialed. So I was banking on that, but you have to get there first.
So then who thinks that Nale should stick the dyno on the next go? No pressure.
No.
As someone that has bouldered the hardest boulder problem in the world and having tried pretty much all of these moves, I'm not going to ask you how it compares, but you can give us a pretty good indication how hard this is.
Well, I mean, it gets progressively harder, so I'm sure some of the upper moves are pretty close to some of the moves on this thing. So, and any move is hard when you're pumped, so there's always that.
Is this route possible?
I think it should be. I mean, that's the idea. I think all the moves have been kind of sort of done, maybe, so.
Well, we'll have to wait and see. €5,000 for the first person to do it. Nale, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Good luck for the next attempt.
Thanks.
And of course, that brings us to our fifth and final competitor of the first round. It's the bad guy, Mr. Magnus Midbo.
The dual-axle Camelot was introduced in 1987, and since then, we've created a whole family of Camelots around that concept.
Camelot's been in our line for a long time, and the only real complaint we ever had about it was that it was heavy if you had a big rack. So we basically dove into this thing just looking at ways to pull weight out without losing any of the functionality that everybody likes so much.
The challenge was trying to make something that's already awesome lighter. We ended up with the Camelot Ultralight.
Put my fingers on the trigger, it's what I'm used to. It feels exactly the same, but 25% lighter.
The single largest contributing factor to weight of a Camelot is the steel cable.
We found pretty quickly that ropes give you the ability to splice in a continuous loop without any sewing, which reduces the size and weight of the system significantly.
That is when the light bulb went off and we were like, okay, now we're on the way.
We also hogged out a bunch of metal from the cam loads, which cut a significant amount of weight. These lobes maintain the same cam angle as the original Camelot, maximizing placements and maintaining strength.
So you can carry less Camelots for the amount of weight that you have with you.
When people started going really light, it enabled them to link these huge mountain chains and climb big faces in a day, and sort of the magnitude of the climbs that were getting done got so much bigger. That was before the ultralights were around, so now that they're here, it's just gonna continue to grow.
I'm a 28-year-old rock climber, live in Norway. I compete, I travel, climb outside. I do whatever I like, kinda. And right now I'm in Stockholm, doing this comp. My climbing style, well, it's probably not very like technical, not very, it's more like campus style, not rely on power. The project, I think, is a cool idea, you know, because you get to try it, and you also, it's a social thing, you know, you get to try it with your friends. So I think we're a good group of people here. And we all have similar beta, but still different, you know. We climb differently, and kind of, it's also a learning process, I feel like, because in a normal comp, you don't learn so much. You just climb, and then you don't really pay too much attention to the other people. You just focus on yourself, but here you have to actually, like, try to observe what the other people are doing and learn from that and take from that and try again, try their beta, and that's it's a cool process. So I do like this format. The route is really hard though. But in rock grade, I feel like this could very well be 9B. It's probably the hardest indoor route I've ever tried, and I've tried a lot of indoor routes. Well, we all bring a lot to the project, I feel like, and we're very different in climbing style and approach, and even how we work, you know, we work it differently. Some of us just have like two attempts and go fast through it, while other people are like actually trying the route, trying to get a high point and preparing themselves in that way, you know. So I think we can learn from just the approach, like how to work a project, because we all do it so differently. Right now, I think Stefano looks the strongest. Yeah, so my money would be on him.
Was Magnus Mittbo, and we know what he thinks about the route and who he thinks going to win. And he thinks Stefano is going to be the guy to top the route. A couple of people asking questions on the live feed comments. Ellis Carson, Tori Morley said, how long is the route? Ellis Carson said 15 meters, but actually this route, whilst the height isn't particularly high, it's probably about 18 meters high, the actual amount of climbing is close to 25 meters, because this route really winds around the whole wall. Magnus Mittbo, the 28 Norwegian, during a conversation last week, or rather earlier this week, Magnus said he thought that climbing needed a bad guy. And we said that maybe he should be the bad guy, and he said no, but then we've insisted that Magnus is now the bad guy. So this is the joke that you might hear now during the competition. Moving up through that steep section, the first horizontal section, very dynamic. Double toe hook. Reaches up to make the clip. And into that first hold over the lip. And this is where the difficulty accelerates somewhat. From the initial easier moves, it gets harder quickly. Reaches over the left, takes that crimp with the right. Clips off that low left foot. And you see him stepping into that disc with the right hand there. Very small holds, big lock, but he holds it. Look at that. Excellent core tension from Magnus Mittbo. makes the clip as he drops that right knee to bring him closer to the wall, reaches over with the right hand to the volume. High clip there off that good hold in that strong position. And it's hard to tell from that angle, but this part of the wall's already about 20 degrees overhanging. Campus is through, steps into that seam, using those soft boots. Magnus opts for softer boots for more sensitivity through the climbing. Look at him go, moving really well, Magnus Midtbert at this point. Magnus, the second climber of the evening who has climbed 9B. He's also on-sighted 8C+. Look at him go, so relaxed. He's absolutely loving it. Just shaking out on those absolutely terrible slopers. I have to say, these slopers are so poor. And this is the big move. Let's see what he does with this. Sticks it first time, and look at that. Opts to go underneath with the left hand to slow that swing down. Brilliant work, and he makes the clip. And now this is the point where he has to compose himself, because every move gets more difficult, and now he's in the horizontal section. There's absolutely no respite whatsoever. Shaking out move by move where he can, but these shakes are just little bits to try and keep any pump at bay that he can. Reaches back down with the right hand, places that right toe left into the bicycle. Oh no, he's off! Magnus falls, so Stefano Gisolfi takes the high point so far. Great effort from Magnus Midtbert. Waves to the crowd. Let's find out what he thought about that route. We'll go and grab him as soon as he's untied from his rope. How was it?
It was pretty good. It's different to climb it now than before, you know.
Why so?
There's a little bit of pressure, not much. And I know that you're on the ground looking at me. I get pretty intimidated.
Come on. Those guys should intimidate you. Are you guys intimidated? They're not sure.
After you calling me Dr. Evil, they don't dare to say otherwise.
I was trying to explain to the guys at home on the live stream exactly what the bad guy is. Who thinks Magnus could be a good bad guy?
Not really.
So just explain to us, as you're getting through that section, it gets harder, obviously, but what is specifically harder at that point?
The holds are a lot worse, and it's a lot steeper.
Good.
Yeah, it's that simple, really.
And you stumped me. Well, you have one more go.
I do?
Yeah, you do. Okay. Do you think you can beat the high point? Do you think you can beat Stefano?
I don't know. This is not my high point. See, that yesterday I did, got two holes further.
Did you peak too soon?
Maybe I peaked too soon.
Ladies and gentlemen, who thinks he's going to get a high point? The guys back home think you're going to get a high point. Okay. They've been very, very supportive on the comments.
Oh, that's nice.
Go recover. Have some birthday cake.
Okay.
We'll see you shortly.
Maybe.
Magnus might go home. Alex, that was the end of the first round.
Oh, already?
Yeah, so that's all five climbers. They've got another attempt.
Well, then it's your turn, Liam.
It's not my turn. But tell me, from those five climbers, what was your highlight?
My highlight? Well, obviously Magnus waving into the crowd.
The guy looks so casual.
Yeah. I mean, that gives him quite a few style points. So actually, if you might add on the style points to his high point, he might actually be first, you know? Does it work like that?
Obviously it does. Alex Magos with logic as always. We're going to go back round to our first climber, which is, of course, Dutch, Jorg Verhoeven.
The Flying Dutchman.
The real adventures don't fit conveniently between a sunrise and a sunset. That spark of excitement and the tingle of consequence that drives us all happens when the world is sleeping. When the air is brisk and a cloak of darkness leaves you alone at the center of a pinprick of light. Within the edges of a headlamp's beam, everything is in sharper focus, and the dark magnifies your heartbeat. strive for this same focus once the sun has risen, dedicating our time and our bodies to perfecting it, that focus. We can find it in the sound of our partner's whoop when they're high above us, and we can find it during the crux of a run out. We find it in the grit between our teeth when we're 6 days into red pointing a route. We find it in the constellations of crimps that we know will go. We find it in a perfectly slotted stopper, in the light of the setting sun. We can find that same focus 10 pitches in when the sun is long gone. These moments are the most real, and they aren't limited to the daytime hours. The thing is, the dark isn't the end of the day. Sometimes, it's just the beginning.
So, Jörg is actually getting prepared right this second. He's putting his shoes on, despite me saying his name. Despite there only being 5 climbers, it seemed that you forgot he has another attempt, Alex.
Yeah, I think he went to the bathroom to put up some makeup.
I think it's because of his age.
It might be.
He's almost ready.
Almost ready. I came back from the bathroom. Beauty queen.
Now, you've done some hard climbing.
Really?
Well, I don't know. How tired is Jörg going to be? He's not had that long to recover.
Well, that obviously depends on the age of the climber. So I obviously wouldn't be tired at all, but considering that he's double my age, I think he needs about triple the recovery time. So that means he should be still totally pumped.
How is it that you get away with giving the other climbers so much abuse?
It's actually not too bad, to be honest. I mean, at least gives you something to do when you're injured.
Well, the guys at home, of course, want Jörg to climb well. What about you guys? What do you think Jörg's going to do this time? Is he going to get higher? How are you all? Are you enjoying the show?
Yes.
What about Alex? He's doing a good job. Two people think you're doing a good job.
Thanks, you too.
If you are tuned in at home, then make sure you drop us a comment in the live chat on Facebook. Or if you tuned in on Twitter, then you can use the hashtag TheBDProject. Let us know what you think about the climbers and let us know who you think is going to win. You ready, Jörg?
Yes, he's ready.
He's ready. So, ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Jörg Verhoeven. Jörg Verhoeven gets ready to begin his second attempt, and of course his final attempt. Jefe Brett Harter, he says, great commentary, that's nice of you to say, thank you very much. So Jörg gets into that horizontal section. Flying Dutchman moves through the section very quickly. Look at the speed limit at this point. Makes the clip off the double jug, reaches up with the right hand. Makes the move with the right hand up to that clip. Takes the pinch with the left hand, really squeezing that left hand, getting the best out of it that he can. He makes that lock off the left look so, so good. Very strong indeed. Big reach with the left hand to make that clip and then into the sloper section. This is where the difficulties really ramp up. They reckon that the first part of the route is 7A plus French grade, up to the first lip. Then, after that, it gets incredibly hard. The difficulties at this point are in the 8A region, and then it gets even harder. And of course, it's set like boulder problems, so trying to trying to define them as a route is very difficult. Oh, and he misses the dyno. Oh, big fall from Jörg. Definitely tired. We'll have to go and see what he thinks of his second attempt. No high point for Jörg Verhoeven, but a great effort. Let's get his thoughts.
Here we are again.
How was that?
Tiring, more tiring than the first time.
Why?
Because of my, you know, too short break. Alex told you all about it. Like three times his age and stuff.
Can you tell us a little bit about that dyno? Because, I mean, on the first go, you made it look pretty easy. The other guys make it look really easy, but it's obviously not easy.
No, it's not. First time I did make it look easy. This actually, for me, there's two betas. This time I tried the lower foot. Gets your biggest swing, didn't hit the hole quite right. So I didn't stick it.
And how good is the hold that you go into?
It's good, but it's really round, and like it feels like you need to go all the way around the corner. Yeah, sometimes you didn't hit it.
No high point for you tonight, but do you think you'll come back?
Well, definitely.
Who wants to see Jörg Verhoeven back here trying the project?
See, I'll be back.
Jörg, they loved you. The people at home loved you. Thank you so much for putting the effort in. Great work. Give me that microphone.
No,
I'm going to give this to Alex. Kaiser, get yourself tied in, get ready. Alex, that was a great effort.
That was a really great effort, yep.
Can you give him some tips for improving?
Well, I think the age thing, he cannot turn that back, so I think he has to file a bit on his technique, I reckon.
So next up we have Kaiser Rosen, the local girl.
Yes.
Kaiser struggled with that first big lock off the right hand. Do you think she can stick it this time, Alex?
Well, I hope so. I mean, you have to consider that for her, that lock off move is a little bit harder since she's about 30 centimeters smaller than, for example, Jörg. So all the holds for her a bit further away. I mean, she can hold on for a very long time, but if it's really hard to pull between the holds, she's going to struggle. So I would say the route doesn't really fit her style that much.
I'm just trying to work out where she is. Oh, she's there. She's tying in. That's good news. Do you have a top tip for anyone that's watching at home that might come and try this route? What's your top tip to them?
Cool. I reckon get a pro belayer. That's for sure the top tip.
Did you hear that, guys? If you want to try this route, it's not how hard you climb, it's how good your belayer is. Are you okay with that? How many pro belayers are in the building?
Whoa, slow down. There's just one pro belayer in this building.
It looks
like
I'll
be here till Wednesday. So whoever wants a belay, just ring me up.
There it is, an open offer for a belay on the project from Alex Magos. In the meantime, let's check out Kaiser Rosen on her second attempt. So, Kaiser Rosen begins her second attempt, and of course, that first move that we saw her struggle with before, very, very difficult. Lots of people saying they want a belay from Mr. Magos. Of course, this route, the Black Diamond Project, is regarded to be the hardest route ever set indoors. Each section of five moves is a boulder grade, the first being 6A, font 6A that is, the second being font 6B, the third being font 6C. Kaiser already into the second section. People are asking, how can you watch this if you don't have a Facebook account? That's a great question. This will be on YouTube after the event, so you can't tune in live, but you can watch it as a replay. Kaiser pops to that right-hand sloper, rolls over, reaches in onto the double toe hook. That position feels really good. You can shake on that sloper. In this instance, the footholds feel better than the handholds. And then this is where it really kicks in. Hits the hold with her right. This is where you have to cut loose. Place that foot first time. Great work from Kaiser. Rolls up with the right hand, hits it with the left. pinch with the right hand, and then she goes to the volume, different beta to everybody else. Of course, as I mentioned, she is much shorter than the rest of the climbers, so she does have to opt for a slightly different beta. Up with the right hand to that crimp, back in with the left, and this is the big move. Oh, and she just pops again. Just too far for Kaiser Rosen on this occasion, but of course this is an open project, so she can come back and try this anytime. See if she can get a high point. One thing to mention is that every year on the 31st of December, the person with the high point for that year will get a cash prize. So it refreshes every year, and there's always the chance to come back the year after and get another high point and win more money. So we'll have to see. Now let's see what Kaiser thought of the route. So, Kaiser, you look stronger this time, I have to say. Do you think she looked stronger this time? Did you feel stronger?
Correct.
What was different?
I don't know. It felt just much better.
Nice. Yeah? I'll take that. So one thing that I just mentioned to the viewers at home on the live stream is, of course, even though tonight you didn't get a high point,
No. You're
the local girl. So you can keep working on this and put some time into maybe get the high point.
Mm-hmm. Everyone should watch out. Yeah?
Fighting talk! So you think you can get the high point for this year?
This year?
Yeah, so the high point at the end of the year, December the 31st, mm-hmm. The person with the highest tick gets cash.
That's good to know.
You didn't know that?
No.
So now you're definitely going to try. Uh-huh. Have you got any messages for the people that were supporting you back home?
Well,
I know you're at home, but there were people on the live stream that
on
were supporting
the live stream.
You. Yeah.
Yeah, I can really feel the support, and thank you.
And what about these folks?
The best crowd ever.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. Congratulations on a great attempt, and hopefully you'll be getting a high point sometime later this year.
Yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more round of applause for Kaiser Rosen. Hopefully, Stefano Gisolfi is tied in and ready to go. But before he starts, Alex, that was pretty impressive.
That was really impressive. She looked more solid than low a bit. I think she just missed the upper hold. I mean, for her, the move is really far. So she went for it and missed it. I mean, happens.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd ask you to start a huge round of applause for birthday boy, Mr. Stefano Gisolfi. So Stefano Gisolfi begins his second attempt at the route. Alex Frick has commented on the live stream. Lots of people have commented, but Alex Fricker says, don't let Mele but Magos belay, because he's never belayed a send harder than 9A. Alex, that's not true. He, in fact, belayed Stefano Gisolfi's 9B belay just a couple of weeks ago when he sent first round, first minute. Tim Lowe says, let's get Steve McClure on this. That'd definitely be interesting to see. Stefano is a very similar physique to Steve McClure. But it would be interesting to see Mr. Mack on it. Stefano cuts loose on that first big sloper with the right hand, matches in with the left, places those feet, and there he is on that jug. I say jug, it's not a jug at all, it's a jug for him. You can match it, very rounded, slopey hold. It's enough just to have a quick shake. Big shout out to Jackie Hwethley. Jackie, of course, one of the shapers at Kilter Grips and also a headsetter at the Spot Gym. I believe it's the Spot. I'm sorry if it's not. I believe the Spot Gym in Colorado, Boulder, Colorado. These holds that Stefano's climbing on. Some of the holds that Jackie's involved with creating. Dylan Hannaford says, how do you know who gets the high point? Well, everybody has to video themselves or be videoed on the route. If you want to get the high point, then you have to have a video. Very easy to do. Everyone's got a smartphone these days. Stefano reaches across and underneath with that right hand onto that block's volume. Lots of people asking, where's Adam Andre? Adam will be here later in the year. He couldn't make it at the moment because he's climbing in Spain. But Adam will be back in Stockholm in a couple of months' time to see what he can do with the high point. Stefano reaches over with that right hand to that big pinch, up with the left. Look how casual he looks at this point. places the heel. Look how casual and calm he looks. Jack was asking who's here today. Well, we've got Jörg Verhoeven and Kaiser Rosen, who've already climbed in their second attempt. This is Stefano Gisolfi of Italy. This is his second attempt. Then we'll have Nalle Huckatäivel and Magnus Mittbert with their second attempts. And that will finish the competition. Stefano cruising that dyno. Look how strong he is. Hanging there one-handed. So calm. Having a great time. He currently has the high point for today's competition, but he'll be looking to push that high point further because Magnus Mittbo is chomping at the bit for another attempt. You can see Stefano trying to catch the route, catch his breath on the route rather. Alex Fricker's asking who wants to see me give it a go. Well, Alex, there's already videos online of me trying it. We actually showed at the beginning of the broadcast a clip of me trying the route, so you can tune into the replay to see that. Stefano reaches over with the left hand onto the right side of that big slopey disc. All the athletes were saying how crazy these holds are. They look huge, but they're very, very rounded. Really looking pumped now, Stefano Gisolfi, as he places that bicycle into the underside, just slowing down that swing. Look at him go, moving really, really well. The crowd absolutely getting behind him. Can he make this next clip? There it is. Now, he got further than this before. Jack Walker's asking who set these routes. Jukka Berglund and Robert Rundin were the setters. And Stefano Gisolfi is looking so strong. Kicks the feet out in front of him. Look at him go. Unbelievable. Chalking up at the same time. Incredible core tension. The crowd absolutely loving it. He's off. Amazing work for the birthday boy. Phenomenal effort from Stefano Gisolfi, 24 years old. Climbed Phytor at first round, first minute just a few weeks ago. Took a gold medal at the World Cup this season. This guy is on incredible form. And he currently has the high point. We'll go and see if we can catch up with him and see what he thinks about the route.
Very good try, though.
Thank you very much.
Are you tired?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, what did you think of that? It's so exciting to watch you climbing. The way that you move through that roof section is so dynamic and so aggressive in a lot of ways. How does it feel when you're up there?
I was tired from the first attempt, but yeah, it's pretty much my style. I feel really good.
Did the birthday cake give you any extra energy?
I didn't eat it.
You didn't eat it?
We can eat it together now.
I've got work to do.
Okay.
There you go. That's for the birthday cake.
Okay, thank you.
Safety first.
No.
Style first.
There's a lot of people on the live stream that were cheering for you in Italian. Lots of Italian people, very supportive. Is there any message that you'd like to give anyone at home?
Ciao a tutti gli italiani che mi stanno seguendo e vi ringrazio and thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give one round of applause for Mr. Stefano Gisolfi. Congratulations, man.
Thank you.
So, Alex, Stefano still has the high point.
Yep, I think he might make himself a birthday present.
You don't think Nalle and Magnus can challenge it?
Well, I said he might. So there's still two climbers to come, so it's still an open competition. But Nalle has a good chance. If he gets to the upper part, where it actually starts getting hard, he'll just piss it because he's so strong.
Well,
he has to get there first.
He does need to get there first. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Nale Hukatayval. So, of course, here is the world's best boulderer, Nale Hukatayval. Jackie Hweftley with the absolute knowledge coming in to say that these are the Kaiju series from Kilter Grips. The big holds are from Ian, who is Kilter Grips' main man. Jimmy Webb carved the big slopers before the dino. Alex Puccio carved the big pinches. Jeremy Ho did the big flat in-cuts before the first roof. So, let's see how Nale manages. This time, of course, he is a boulderer. Doesn't often tie into a rope. And after the working session, he looked so, so strong. It's absolutely unbelievable. He was doing the moves in the roof, in the high section of this, with absolutely no problem at all, really showing that bouldering strength that he has. And as we just alluded to in that interview, if Nale can get up to that dino, it's possible that he can link those moves together. But he has to fight the pump if he wants to get up there. If you are tuned in at home, a very warm welcome to klattercentret in Stockholm. My name's Leon Lonsdale, and I'll be looking after you for the rest of the evening. Of course, Alex Magos is on the microphone as well. Nale reaches down to make that clip. If you want to get in touch on Twitter or Instagram, use the hashtag TheBDProject, looking back as that little foot pop. But he's strong as he moves to that sloper. Stands into the seam, very precise footwork there. Oh, and he's off! Just struggling again. Too pumped. Shakes his head. Tim Lowe said this would be great above a pool without ropes. After seeing what they say, let's see if we can grab a few words from Nale.
So, Nale, how was that?
Well, considering it's the first time I ever do a rope climbing competition, I think it was pretty good.
What do you think? First time he's ever done a rope climbing competition.
I'm pretty proud of not messing up any of the clips, so that's a new game for me.
You didn't back clip, you didn't Z clip.
No, nothing like that. They didn't pull me off the wall for skipping or doing something back clip, so that's always a plus.
Lots of people on the live stream were saying things like, oh my gosh, this guy is so strong, etc., etc. Obviously, you are very strong, but how frustrating is it to know that you can do these moves, but you can't get there?
It is frustrating. That's one part about endurance climbing, I think, that really gets me frustrated, when you're hanging in a jug and just watching your fingers open up. But when you do endurance climbing for a while, even I can get pretty good endurance, so we just have to do it. And coming from bouldering, it's pretty challenging. But you can compensate with power so much, but you still need that endurance there.
For sure. And one thing that we talked about earlier today was how when you do go and try routes, that you like to try something that doesn't suit you.
Yeah.
For example, the project. Will you be back?
I mean, it's not a far flight for me, so I'd love to come back. Come for that $5,000.
Who wants to see Nale come for the $5,000? And there was lots of people tuned in on the live stream from Finland cheering you on in Finnish. Is there any messages you'd like to give at home?
Kiitos kaikille, ketkä katsoo. Kuka ei varmaan ymmärrä tätä kieltä, kun mä puhun, mutta suomalaisille terve ja kippis kaikille.
I think you said something like, that was really good, cheers.
A lot of swear words. I'm going to have to censor it all out.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, one more time, give a huge round of applause for Mr. Nale Hukatayval.
Thanks.
Cheers, buddy.
Good one.
Get out of here. Alex, how was that for you?
Well, that was impressive to watch. I mean, considering that he's a boulderer, he still got further than the try before, did he?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that means his recovery is pretty good. So if he actually starts training a bit of endurance, I think he might just come back and take the $5,000.
Well, it's our fifth and final athlete of the second round. This is the moment that we've been waiting for. Mr. Magnus Mittberg is going to see if he can take the high point. You need to call it right now. I'm putting you on the spot. And he's listening.
Well, Magnus, off you go. Get it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge round of applause and a very warm welcome to Mr. Magnus Midburg.
And of course, here is 28-year-old Norwegian climber Magnus Midburg. Incredibly strong athlete. Big shout out to Dave Barons and Marcus Young who are tuned in. Both very talented boulderers. And route climbers as well. Magnus moving through that section in the lower part very quickly and easily. Very efficient indeed. Alex Magos in the background saying that Magnus is collecting style points. Moving incredibly quickly through this low section. Of course, the Black Diamond Project is a permanent project in that it will stay on the wall until it's been sent. Anyone can come and try this. Americans are allowed. Anyone's allowed. All you have to do is come down to klattercentret telephone plan in Stockholm. Sign up, register, pay for your entry, just the entry to the wall, and then you can climb. As long as you film it. Mr. David Graham saying, can he come and try this? Dave, get yourself down here. I will belay. Magnus makes the clip off that block's volume, reaches up with the left hand to the big sloper, and then stands in the seam of that wall. Puts the heel in, reaches up with the right hand. And he's already looking a little bit pumped. Oh, and he cuts loose and he's off. Oh, no. That is not the finish that Magnus was hoping for. It's a great effort from Magnus Mitbo. But not quite the finish that he wanted. We'll see if we can grab a quick word with him and see what he thinks.
So, Magnus, that wasn't quite the finish I don't think you were hoping for.
No, I wasn't. I was feeling pretty good, but...
You looked good. You flew through that low section.
I know, I had to fly.
How pumped are you?
Pretty pumped, but I was hoping to be a little more pumped.
And it was a foot pop, it looked like.
Yeah, the heel. But it's kind of insecure, you know? And if you're a little bit pumped, it's like easy to fall, mess it up.
These things happen, I guess.
Yeah, I'm still happy. It was fun.
What's the quality of the setting like on this route? I mean, it looks good, but how does it actually climb?
It climbs really well. I mean, all the moves are about the same. I mean, they're all hard, and it gets progressively harder, so it's really hard to set. A lot of testing involved and bringing in people, seeing with, like, different heights and stuff and how it works. So I think they did a great job.
Will you be coming back for another go?
Yeah, I mean, it's not too far from where I live, Oslo.
You're kind of busy in Oslo at the moment.
A little bit busy, but never really busy. Oh, climbers always complain if they're a little bit busy, but there's always time.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, what did you think of Magnus's attempt? The guys at home were absolutely loving it. A lot of Norwegians tuned in.
That's cool.
Any shout-out that you'd like to give?
Message
to the guys at home?
Message in Norwegian? Or
yeah,
what?
You say what you want.
Ja, takk for at jeg så på. Synd at det ikke bedre på i andre forsøk, men ruten, den går ikke noe sted. Og det kan godt være at jeg kommer tilbake.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, one more time, a huge round of applause for Magnus Midburg. Good job, dude. So now, hopefully, we can grab a quick word with Stefano Gisolfi. He might be eating his birthday cake. But I believe, while we wait for Stefano, you can show us a videotape.
The dual axle Camelot was introduced in 1987, and since then we've created a whole family of Camelots around that concept.
Camelot's been in our line for a long time, and the only real complaint we ever had about it was that it was heavy if you had a big rack. So we basically dove into this thing just looking at ways to pull weight out without losing any of the functionality that everybody likes so much.
The challenge was trying to make something that's already awesome lighter. We ended up with the Camelot Ultralight.
Thank you.
put my fingers on the trigger, it's what I'm used to. It feels exactly the same, but 25% lighter.
The single largest contributing factor to weight of a Camelot is the steel cable.
We found pretty quickly that ropes give you the ability to splice in a continuous loop without any sewing, which reduces the size and weight of the system significantly.
That is when the light bulb went off and we were like, okay, now we're on the way.
We also hogged out a bunch of metal from the cam loads, which cut a significant amount of weight. These lobes maintain the same cam angle as the original Camelot, maximizing placements and maintaining strength.
So you can carry less Camelots for the amount of weight that you have with you.
When people started going really light, it enabled them to link these huge mountain chains and climb big faces in a day, and sort of the magnitude of the climbs that were getting done got so much bigger. And that was before the ultralights were around, so now that they're here, it's just gonna continue to grow.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, how about a round of applause for our current high point and winner from tonight, Mr. Stefano Gisolfi. Stefano, you have the high point. How does that feel?
Yeah, it feels great. I'm just sorry that we had a short break before the second attempt, and everybody should have climbed better if we have more break, but it's a competition. It's like
it's the way it goes, I guess.
Yeah, it's the way it goes.
Stefano, do you think that your high point will stay the high point for the next 10 months, or do you think somebody can get up there between now and then? Adam Ondra said he's going to come down.
I think they will set another high point because we worked just not too much, just three times yesterday, so they will just set another high point.
Good. Well, congratulations once more. Ladies and gentlemen, one more time, a round of applause for Stefano Gisolfi, and of course, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Alex, just summarize, you know, in a few words, what you thought of this opening of the Black Diamond competition.
Whoa. That was pretty much it. I mean, it was absolutely amazing to watch these guys climb. And I mean, I pretty much saw the whole process. I've seen the videos, how they put up the route, how much time it took to actually set the route. And then I saw them work the route 2 days ago. I saw them work the route yesterday. And then I saw the event going down today, and it was absolutely amazing.
Well, you're currently injured, but do you think that you'll be back to try it?
Oh, for sure I'll be back to try it. I mean, Stockholm is pretty much my third living room after Café Kraft and my actual living room, so I'll definitely be back.
Who wants to see Alex Magos on this route? Well, you've pretty much got to do it. Before you go, is there anything you'd like to say to the people back home watching in Germany?
Oh, auf Deutsch. Also, ich muss definitiv meine kleine Schwester grüßen, weil sonst bringt die mich um das nächste Mal. Und ich grüße auch meinen Freund Felix und meine ganze Crew im Café Kraft. Dankeschön.
So, there, of course, was Alex Magos, and that finishes pretty much the event for tonight. But that doesn't mean that the competition's over. In fact, it's only just begun, and anyone, including you at home, can come to Stockholm, come to klattercentret, and try the route for yourselves. 5,000 euros will go to the person that tops it first. Is that incentive?
Yeah, pretty good. And I mean, 1,000 euros go for the person who has the high point in each year. So, I mean, it's definitely more than the flight to Stockholm.
Yeah, so get yourselves down here, come and try it. Make sure you video yourself on the attempt. A big thank you, of course, to all the sponsors from the event, Ligula, 510, Blocks, Kilter Grips, of course, and Black Diamond, I don't know if you've...
I think Black Diamond was as well a sponsor.
Yeah, the Black Diamond Project, of course. It wouldn't be possible without them. That's it for tonight from klattercentret here in Stockholm. This guy's been Alex Magos. I've been Liam Lonsdale. And until next time, good night.
Good night.
The real adventures don't fit conveniently between a sunrise and a sunset. That spark of excitement and the tingle of consequence that drives us all happens when the world is sleeping. When the air is brisk and a cloak of darkness leaves you alone at the center of a pinprick of light. Within the edges of a headlamp's beam, everything is in sharper focus, and the dark magnifies your heartbeat. We strive for this same focus once the sun has risen, dedicating our time and our bodies to perfecting it, that focus. We can find it in the sound of our partner's whoop when they're high above us, and we can find it during the crux of a run out. We find it in the grit between our teeth when we're 6 days into red pointing a root. We find it in the constellations of crimps that we know will go. We find it in a perfectly slotted stopper, in the light of the setting sun. We can find that same focus 10 pitches in when the sun is long gone. These moments are the most real, and they aren't limited to the daytime hours. The thing is, the dark isn't the end of the day. Sometimes it's just the beginning.